Good evening, folks. If I can ask you to make your way to your seats so we can begin today's event. Thank you very much. So, folks, if I can ask you to make your way to your seats, please, so we can begin our lecture this evening. Okay, so good evening. Good evening, everyone. You're very welcome to the 2023 Irish Aid Annual Professor Father Michael Kelly Lecture on HIV and AIDS. And the theme, of course, of this year is Let Communities Lead. And my name is Mihindi Kulasuria Nancy Lea Dilhani Vikramasinghe. That's not my address, that's not my life story, that's my name, but you can call me Dil. So you're all very welcome once again to our beautiful Smock Alley Theatre. It's the home for our Professor Father Michael Kelly lecture. I'm kind of losing count at this stage, how many years I've been doing this, but it's an absolute privilege to be here. So you're all very welcome. Just a few points for you. The event is being live streamed to the Irish Global Health Network YouTube channel. So welcome to everyone who is watching us from far afield. Maybe we will give them all a big Irish welcome by giving... Yay! Yeah, people always join and watch this lecture from far afield, so it's lovely for them to feel our Irish warmth. And speaking of Irish warmth, is anyone else shell-shocked by the cold today? I was like, there was a false sense of security, you know, last week. I thought, this is okay, we're going to be fine this winter. And then today, it just came out of nowhere. Okay, so it's not just me. Great. So a recording of the event will also be made available afterwards if you'd like to watch it back or you'd like to share it with anyone who is not here today and would like to see it. We encourage you to share messages of this event on Twitter and other social media platforms using the hashtag FMK23. And, of course, hashtag WAD2023, which, of course, is the official hashtag for World AIDS Day. You can also mention us in your posts, as in the Irish Global Health Network, and also use our social media handles that are on the slides behind me, please. That would be amazing. There you go. Perfect. Like magic. Okay. So World AIDS Day, observed on the 1st of December every year, is an international day dedicated to raising awareness about HIV and AIDS. And it is an opportunity for people worldwide to unite and show support for those living with HIV, commemorate those who have died from AIDS-related illnesses, and advocate for increased efforts to prevent new infections. And as I said, the theme for this year of World AIDS Day 2023 is Let Communities Lead. So the communities living with and affected by HIV, networks of people from key populations and youth leaders have been and continue to be essential for progress in our response to HIV. So the world can end AIDS with communities leading the way, indeed. And that is why the theme of the World AIDS Day this year is Let Communities Lead, because they are going to lead the way to end infections and bring us to zero infections. And it's much more than a celebration of the achievements of communities. It's in fact a call to action to enable and support communities in their leadership roles. So that's really going to be the conversation this evening, and we're going to have a number of amazing speakers, and we'll also have a panel discussion, and then you'll also have an opportunity through our conversation to actually comment and ask questions yourself. So I'm going to just now hand over to Michael Gaffney to open the event. And Michael Gaffney is the Director General at the Development Corporation and Africa Division of IrishAid. Everybody, please give a round of applause. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dil, and great to see so many people here. Hello to everyone who's watching us online, and a special hello to all of you who have come out on this cold and rainy evening for this very warm event. It's a great honour now as Director General of IrishAid to be here at the 18th annual Father Michael Kelly Lecture on HIV and AIDS. Father Michael was, as I'm sure virtually everyone here knows, a renowned advocate and brave advocate on HIV and AIDS, with a lifelong commitment to the promotion of education and social justice in Zambia and in right across Africa. And his loss has been great, but we have continued and will continue with this series of lectures in his honour, and in honour of all of those who are fighting or have succumbed to HIV and AIDS, and in the hope that we do reach the solution and the ending of this terrible disease that we are all working so hard for. I'm really glad to be back here. I remember it feels like just yesterday that we were in this very room discussing the same subject. I want to give a special mention to the members of Father Michael Kelly's family who are here. I think it is really important that they come every year to this lecture, and I speak for everyone, I'm sure, when I say our gathering here today is a testament to his huge commitment and to your persistence in that. So it's now more than 40 years since the first case was reported, and the disease continues to affect millions around the world. HIV is relentlessly persistent in its presence, so the global community has an absolute obligation to accelerate its response. There are improvements, very, very significant improvements. In 2022, nearly 30 million people were on antiretrovirals, and that's the highest number to date. More people are living healthy, normal lives as a result. But for all the gains made, AIDS still claims 630,000 lives each year, most of them in disadvantaged and poor communities and among people from marginalized and vulnerable populations. So clearly, there is a huge amount more to be done in a progressively complex context. We live, as everyone knows these days, in a world of crisis, a world of polycrisis, a world of overlapping crises. And sometimes it can seem overwhelming, but it is really important in our work, especially as we focus on this area of work, it's really important that we not be overwhelmed by what seems an almost hopeless picture. With first of all COVID, then the invasion of Ukraine, and we had a great speaker from Ukraine here with us last year, but a year later, the people of Ukraine are still suffering on. With the conflict in Sudan that is so often forgotten and often not mentioned at all, but which is a catastrophic conflict having huge humanitarian impact, and now the appalling situation in Gaza. These crises are compounding already existing needs. And 2022 saw a reduction in resources available for HIV in low and middle income countries, 21% less than the year before. And we should not be in a situation where people affected by HIV are in effect paying for the impact of these crises. Furthermore, recent statistics show that while HIV infections are decreasing in some regions around the world, they have actually increased in areas such as Eastern Europe and Central Asia, Latin America, and the Middle East and North Africa. All have recorded increases in infections in recent years. Women, girls, persons with disabilities and people already in the margins of society feel the brunt of this failure. And in sub-Saharan Africa, women and girls of all ages accounted for 63% of all new HIV infections last year, 2022. So that is reason enough for a call to action. We have set in the SDGs, we have set an ambition to end AIDS by 2030. And this must remain our goal, and it must drive our work and our ambition. But a change in a trajectory like this requires transformative change. We cannot continue as we have been going. Changes need to be made, and that is why it is really important that this session is devoted to the theme of let communities lead. In the world of development in general, we are looking more and more at what should be obvious but has been hidden, which is the need for communities to have a say and to lead in their own development. We have lots of words to describe it: localization, locally led development. But what it means in essence is that we can't have an approach where we sit in the capitals of Europe and the United States and decree to communities in Africa and elsewhere what they need to do. We need to be listening to them and working with them, because communities around the world are at the forefront of crisis. Organizations within communities living with and at risk of AIDS have lived experiences and informed perspectives that have proven critical in how we shape our response to the fight to end HIV and AIDS. So obstacles to community participation and leadership need to be removed. And that is work that we are trying to do, but we need to do together with civil society and essentially together with the vulnerable communities. I was recently with Minister of State Fleming in both Ethiopia and Uganda just a few weeks ago. And there we had the opportunity to spend time with young people in vulnerable communities and to learn about the many obstacles they face on a daily basis. Foremost among those is, of course, education. And often the obstacles also relate to sexual and reproductive health, including HIV and AIDS. And it's abundantly clear that young girls in particular have enormous obstacles to overcome. So you talk in Karamoja in northern Uganda to a girl of 14 years old who's desperate to move into secondary school, but who had a baby at the age of 12, which has been looked after by her mother, who can't really do it. And the obstacles that she faces in going to secondary school are absolutely something that I think many people in Ireland couldn't even comprehend. And yet her determination to go on to secondary school is what is the sort of thing that needs to drive us. But what also needs to drive us is the ambition to ensure that not only does that girl go to school, but that she should not have had to be pregnant at the age and have a child at the age of 12. Humanitarian crises are also exacerbating the issues that we face in fighting HIV and AIDS. And as a guiding principle for a better world, we are aiming to reach the furthest behind first. And so through our work with key partners such as the Global Fund and the WHO, we're building our support for the prevention and treatment of HIV in these most difficult settings. For instance, we're supporting the provision of urgent sexual and reproductive healthcare in climate-affected communities in places like Ethiopia and Kenya, and conflict-affected communities in Ukraine, Ethiopia, and Somalia. And the UNAIDS 2023 report states that HIV responses succeed when they are anchored in strong political commitment, follow the evidence, have reliable and adequate funding, and reduce inequalities and discrimination. So I think it should be obvious to us that community-led responses are key in this, and that must be a priority for us. I just want to say that as we mark World AIDS Day today, I don't know if you're aware, because I actually wasn't aware until relatively recently, that the government has commissioned a HIV and AIDS National Monument, which will be installed in the People's Park in the Phoenix Park and will be unveiled or launched
Good afternoon.
On Sunday.
I'm Vuyiseka Dubula, the new head of...
Anyway, that was the that was the monument, and that's apparently me. So, but it is this monument is to remember those who have died from HIV and mark their lives and contribution to society. And it will serve as a tribute to those friends, families, and carers who have dedicated their lives to improving HIV care. And I think there is probably no family, perhaps no family in the country, that hasn't, whether they know it or not, been impacted by HIV and AIDS. many families, especially in years gone by, say in the 1980s, lost family members to HIV and AIDS, and yet some of them don't even know that yet. I know it from my own family, a cousin who died, and I think some members of my family do not know that that's why he died. So I think it is really good that now the state is remembering everyone, and that it is the Taoiseach who will be unveiling that monument on Sunday. And that is the monument, which, as you can see, it's an artist's impression of the monument to be called Embraced Loop, and I encourage you to go and visit it. So I just want to say, in concluding, I want to thank Dil yet again for her great chairpersonship, a great moderatorship, and I want to especially thank the Irish Global Health Network for their fantastic collaboration on this year's event. And I also want to thank in advance the incredible speakers that we are going to hear from. It is a real privilege to be with you today, as I know what will be another successful event in honour of Father Michael Kelly and in honour of everyone who is living with HIV and AIDS in our communities today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michael, for those beautiful words to launch us, to launch the event this evening. So now, actually, you have a little snippet of the next piece, our next speaker. We're going to show you a video now, and it's a short message of greeting from Vuyiseka Dubula, I hope I said that right, the new head of the Communities, Rights and Gender team in the Global Fund. She was unable to join us here today due to travel commitments, but was keen to share her thoughts on World AIDS Day and the theme in relation to the partnership with Ireland. So here's a short greeting from her.
Protect the gains. Protect communities. Protect civic space where communities are able to have a voice. Good afternoon. I'm Vuyiseka Dubula, the new head of Community Rights and Gender at the Global Fund. I'm recording this message from Zimbabwe during the pre-conference of Women Now, which is a space that brings young women and older women who have been in the struggle and the response on HIV across the world. And that's why I was unable to come in person to Dublin to join you on your World AIDS Day event. But I know that Olive, who is there in person, will be able to fill the space that I was supposed to fill, but also share her powerful messages for this World AIDS Day. For me, my message, I concur and reinforce the message by UNAIDS of letting communities lead. And for me, it's also an acknowledgement that communities have been leading. This is not a new thing for communities. For the last three decades, communities have been the backbone of the AIDS, TB, and malaria response. To let them lead now is a call for supporting communities to do more than what they do, by funding them differently, by funding them in a flexible way. But funding community-led organization is an investment, but also it's a protection over all the investments that have been made by the government of Ireland. And this message comes at a very important time. It's World AIDS Day 2023. We are faced with multiple concurrent crises. We have a crisis of the unmet needs and demands in the AIDS, TB, and malaria responses because of COVID. We are still recovering from the pandemic, but at the same time, we are also facing anti-rights and anti-gender movements that will really erase all the investment, but also erase all the work we've done together collectively across the globe. And this is a call for everybody in this World AIDS Day to protect the gains. Protect communities, protect civic space where communities are able to have a voice, shift decision-making with policies that affect their lives. Also protect the gains that communities have really been able to bring contribution in the resilience of the public health systems in many countries. And I know that the government of Ireland
is a friend, it's a partner to the Global Fund. It does what it does to support the same call. And so I am also very glad that you are hosting your World AIDS Day, and hopefully that your message and your call to support and continue to fund the response on TB and HIV malaria is a right thing to do, but also as a global public good, is continued, but also that message is heard by other governments who are not supporting the response. I wish you well in this World AIDS Day as we are reflecting, as we are celebrating lives we've saved together, but also celebrating the work that you are doing with us in this partnership, at the same time reminding the world that the fight is not over. We have to fast track all what we were hoping to do and what we've lost because of COVID. And I trust in this partnership that we will do more together. And with those words, have a wonderful World AIDS Day. And I am looking forward to have you and meet you in person one day. But also as a closing, I am also a recipient of your contribution and your support to development, because my PhD was funded by the Irish government through the University of Limerick and in partnership with my university, University of KwaZulu-Natal in Durban, South Africa. Thank you so much for this opportunity to share this small, short message with you.
I had goosebumps there when she was talking about how she benefited from the funding in relation to her own work. So that's incredible. So you'll agree that so far we've had some amazing speakers. Yes. Yeah. So we're going to have another amazing speaker. I am delighted now to introduce our esteemed keynote speaker who's going to have a conversation. I was told not to say keynote. I can't. I have to say it. Sorry. I'm sorry. She's going to have a conversation in relation to all that she does. So our next speaker is Winnie Sanyu Seruma. And Winnie is a freelance international development consultant based in London. Her consultancy work includes facilitating health trainings, community research, program evaluations, and technical assistance, largely supporting community-based organizations responding to issues of social justice, women leadership, and HIV and AIDS. Now, Winnie was born in the UK, grew up in Uganda, and went to university in the US, and where she earned a sociology degree. Winnie has been living with HIV for the last 35 years and is one of the authors and editors of the new book entitled Our Stories Told by Us. So I'm sure she will be telling us a little bit more about this book. So folks, please give her a very warm welcome. Winnie.
Thank you, everyone, for being here this evening. I'm sure there are places you could have been, but you've decided to be here this evening. So thank you for being here. Thank you for the kind introduction. And I hope I will fulfill the role of the lecture that you wanted to say and not the conversation. I know that probably many of you don't know me, hopefully by the time I finish speaking, you'll know a little bit more about me. When I agreed to come here, the next day I thought, what did I just agree to? I felt like I had bitten off more than I could chew. But I hope that I will speak to the very, prominent theme for this year, let communities lead. So here we go. I want to first thank though the Irish Global Health Network for organizing this in partnership with Irish Aid. So thank you for inviting me to address this annual commemoration of Father Michael Kelly ahead of World AIDS Day tomorrow. While I was doing the research in shaping what I wanted to say in relation to World AIDS theme, I read about Professor Michael Kelly. And I have to confess, I knew very little about him. However, I was inspired by the work he did and his personal story. Then next, I looked up the people he spoke alongside with when he was still alive, and those who have given the lectures previous to this one. And I was really struck by how many of those people I know. And, you know, some of them I actually know very well. Some of those people are Stephen Lewis, who has a foundation in Canada. And that foundation I have done work for, monitoring and assessing projects in Africa for the last 8 years. I then looked up another person, Georgina Caswell. I worked with Georgina Caswell in London in a few years when she was living there, and she worked for the African HIV Policy Network. And I chaired the African HIV Policy Network there for 10 years. I then looked up Sean Mellows, Noreen Kaleba, and they are part of the book that I co-authored and co-written with a few of my other friends. I will tell you about this book later. And then Vuyiseka. Vuyiseka is a friend. She's also a fellow activist. I just thought I would start there. We're a community. We are a community, we know each other, we support each other, we are partners, and we have each other's backs. I listened to most of the lectures, and the same themes ran through them. Investing in communities, stories of people living with HIV, the challenges around HIV-related stigma, the vulnerabilities and the marginalization that puts people at risk of acquiring HIV, and the need for girls and women's education and continued empowerment. This is not an exhaustive list, but my point is that I feel that most of what you know has been said in the previous lectures and now is not new to most of you. You've heard most of it. So I wanted to say and talk about something different that perhaps you might not have heard of, that perhaps, you know, is just under the radar and perhaps is so much closer than you think. So, as you've heard, I'm a freelance consultant, and I am in a unique position because I'm not attached to any organization. So I literally can let rip. I'm not restricted by any agendas or themes, but I will spend a lot of time focusing on people's stories. I'll start with my own. I have done a lot of work in the HIV sector in the UK, in Africa, and I'll also tell you about the book, the stories that are in the book that was just launched a few months ago. I will reflect on some areas that I feel we need to pay more attention to, and these are my personal feelings. And I will also briefly touch on what I think the global statistics are telling us and what the reality is on the ground in some communities. I hope that through this approach, I will succeed in addressing or talking to the theme, letting communities lead. My journey started days before the very first World AIDS Day in 1988, when I was diagnosed through an unpaid internship I had embarked on as I continued my studies in North America. I was 27 years old, and my HIV diagnosis came as a real shock to me. It was a time when very little was known in terms of how HIV manifested itself in women's bodies. I was offered the experimental and only antiretroviral drug available at the time, and I took it in the hope of prolonging my life for a little bit longer. As some of you might be aware, the side effects were horrendous, and its effectiveness on its own, very limited. I'm not sure how I survived it. Initially, I didn't talk to my friends or my family about my HIV status. I couldn't face being judged or ostracized while I was still trying to understand what was happening to me. It was a very lonely and stressful time until I decided to return to my ancestral home in Uganda with the hope of dying. By this time, I had lost both my parents to different forms of cancers and a young brother to HIV complications. My thoughts on returning home were driven by the need to spare my younger siblings, mostly my sister though, tons of money, which would have involved bringing me back to Africa in a cascade. I know my relatives would have demanded it, and it would have driven my sister into financial despair. On returning to Uganda and spending a couple of years, I nearly got my wish of dying. I suffered multiple opportunistic infections, but fortunately recovered, mostly because I could afford medication for the opportunistic infections. I was not in denial of my HIV status, and I had support from my only biological sister. In 1996, and with the support of my siblings, I traveled to London, UK, for a 2-week break to really recover. During the 2-week break, I took the opportunity to go and get a checkup and to access peer support for the very first time. Accessing peer support and then, you know, being empowered to access treatment. And by then I had an AIDS diagnosis with a CD4 count of 1. During the break, my life completely and absolutely changed. Not planned, I might add. I made a decision to stay in the UK in order to have a chance to live. It was the practical and rational thing to do, but a decision that didn't come easy. But I've never looked back. I'm very aware that I'm speaking from a privileged position, born in the UK, studying in North America, and having access to effective HIV treatment in the UK for the last 15 or so years, and doing the work that I love to do. I just want to say that privilege doesn't mean a life without challenges. Life can be extremely complex. I now want to tell you about the African communities in the UK. the impact of HIV on those communities. The story, perhaps, that is rarely told. The story of resilience, amazing skills that are absolutely underutilized, and the hope and strength that drives the work that community-led organizations continue to do against all odds. I'm going to speak about the communities through the work I've been involved in with others, individuals, and community organizations. The majority of Africans living with HIV in the UK live in London. That is where I live also, and that's where I'm based in terms of my work. African communities are the second most affected by HIV. Looking at a glance at the evolving HIV epidemic in the UK, new HIV transmissions continue to go down. Most people in care are HIV suppressed, undetectable, and can no longer pass on HIV. Pre-exposure prophylaxis, PrEP, is now accessible on the National Health Service, and very few children are being born with HIV. Thanks to antenatal testing, plus testing in accident and emergency places in some hospitals now in London. It is easy to get caught up in numbers and statistics and forget the complex nature of HIV and how it affects different communities differently. Due to historical underfunding of African-led community organization, structural, social, and health inequalities, the often anti-immigrant environment, marginalization, and so much more, there are still more people from African communities presenting late with HIV. Access to PrEP is not great in African communities, especially where women are concerned. Many Africans experience racism and stigma in clinical settings, not to mention HIV-related stigma within their communities for those living and affected with HIV. And while as Africans, we know that issues of marginalization and inequalities do not define us, they do harm us, especially where healthcare is concerned. It is a topic that needs its own conference and its own lecture. However, African-led organizations have been at the front line of the UK HIV response and continue to be, making sure African community members are HIV aware, access HIV testing, peer support, HIV treatment, and the stigma attached to HIV continues to dissipate. Individuals and organizations have been responsible in supporting communities and services within the UK to make services more culturally appropriate, for lack of a better phrase. Treatment literacy services have been involved in treatment activism for a very long time and continue to provide treatment training for people living with HIV. And many Africans who are living with HIV are doing well and have many of their community organizations to thank for that. The work of the African-led community organizations continues to be highlighted, not in a way that they should. What is usually highlighted are the challenges, the continued challenges, but not the great work that is being done. This book is the first of its kind that has been co-authored and co-written by five Black African women living with HIV from Zambia, from Zimbabwe, from Kenya, and myself from Uganda. Between us, we have about 120 years of lived experience of HIV. We wanted to make sure that the work of community organizations and individuals within the African communities was highlighted and acknowledged. And that, you know, as communities, we've contributed to the UK HIV response, just like all the other organizations that have been involved. I could go on a lot, but as I said in the beginning, I don't like the word lecture. I really like having conversations with people. So I would prefer that perhaps you ask me questions about the book, about my work, about my thoughts on the work that I've been doing, not just in the UK, but in Africa. I would like to end with some random thoughts, very random. There are things that bug me, you know, when I'm traveling, doing work, and I just thought, hey, why not say them out loud? And hopefully somebody will be listening. So here we go. As a member, an active member of the African diaspora, I feel that we are an underutilized resource. We have unlimited skills and can support health programs effectively in the UK, in Europe, and in Africa, if we are given a chance. Number two, young women and girls need empowerment, and it is important to focus on continuing to empower them in a lot of different places around the world, especially in Africa, but not at the cost of young boys and men. Gender inequality is bad for boys too. Number three, as those of us continuing to work on HIV, we need to build more meaningful partnerships with people working on health issues to continue to reduce health inequalities among marginalized communities and to continue to adapt as the HIV epidemic evolves, whether it's nationally or internationally. And finally, I want to repeat the words that Voiseka said. Communities have been leading. They've been at the front lines. What communities want is recognition through increased funding, through listening to what they need, through commissioning, and through making sure that the HIV programs that are funded fulfill the needs of the communities on the ground. Thank you for listening.
Did we say we were going to have some incredible speakers? I mean, thank you, Winnie. I could have listened to you all day. Yeah, I think I'm speaking for everyone in the room when I say that. And thank you so much for really being so generous and sharing your own personal story, and indeed the insights that you have gathered and the things that bug you. Yeah, I think that was very important. Okay, so now it's time for a bit of music. What do you say? One thing about the Father Michael Kelly Lecture, every year we have amazing music, and this year is no different. So it gives me great pleasure to welcome the HSC Healthcare Harmonies Choir to perform for us this evening. And the choir will be led by Emma Crehan, who is a choir director and singer-songwriter, and they will be singing Scars. Emma, take it away.
So I'd like to dedicate this to Nadine Ferris France and all the young people in Zvandiri in Zimbabwe. Nadine is currently over there working with them, and I had the pleasure of dropping in to do a little bit of a workshop with them earlier on, and just sending them loads of love. So this is for them and for all of you.
Yes, it's been long, yes, it's been hard, but surely that's life's plan. To teach you the ways of the human condition, the errors and downfalls of man. To remind you of who you need to become, see mercy before you sleep. To make you alive as the energy falls through these burning tears that you weep. And do these scars cover the whole of you, like the stars and moons in the sky? A sad story means the storyteller's alive, so don't you cry. The next thing you know, something fine will happen, and you'll turn around and smile. So wipe your eyes. A scar means you survived, and life is real. So stand tall out on your own, embracing what's ahead. Listen to music and dance as you laugh, and empty your soul of its lead. Let down your borders and open your floodgates, and try and do as you feel. And always remember that this is it, life is real, life is real. Oh, oh.
Stars.
sad story means a storyteller's alive. So don't you cry. The next thing you know, something fine will happen and you'll turn around and smile. So wipe your eyes. The scar means you survived. And
fabulous. Goodness. The HSC Healthcare Harmonies Choir. You are all rock stars. And of course, the director, singer, songwriter is Emer Crehan, who of course is very much part of this event. And speaking of which, you, Emer, mentioned Nadine Ferris-France, who's not here tonight. It's the first time. It's kind of strange to be here and Nadine not being here. So, Nadine, if you're watching this, we're thinking of you and looking forward to seeing you. Okay, so now it's time for our panel discussion. So I'm going to invite all our panelists to make their way to the front. So this evening, we will be joined on the panel by Vinny and, of course, an Irish Aid Director General, Michael Gaffney. And also, we'll be joined by Olive Mumba and Stephen O'Hare. If you can make your way up, it'd be great. So just to introduce Olive Mumba. Olive works in the Community Rights and Gender Department of the Global Fund to fight AIDS, tuberculosis, and malaria, where she supports meaningful engagement in communities and civil society in emergency and pandemic preparedness and responses programs and policies. And Stephen O'Hare, of course, there's Stephen. Stephen is the Executive Director of HIV Ireland, a nationally focused non-profit community organization working to end new HIV transmissions and advance the rights of people living with HIV. So you're all very welcome to our conversation this evening. So if I can start with yourself, Michael. So considering the evolving landscape of public health, what innovative approaches and or partnerships does Irish Aid explore to adapt and enhance the support for community-led efforts in the fight against HIV and AIDS? I mean, that's the theme tonight. It's about how can we support communities. So what are your thoughts, Michael?
Well, you know, it's not just in this fight that we need to do better and do more. It's across the whole, can you hear me?
Yeah.
It's across the whole area of our development and humanitarian action. There's a big push at the moment coming from civil society, which is good, for us to embrace more locally led interventions. And I think it's very important. It's especially important when you're looking at something like a disease like HIV and AIDS, because there has been a tendency over the years for us to develop, not Irish Aid, but all of us, to develop these great policies and theories of development, and then to give them to those people who actually are experiencing what it means to live in an era of what we call polycrisis. So if you are a very vulnerable woman with a big family in a remote, poor part of Africa, and if there is HIV and AIDS in your family, it's of course not the only challenge you face. You're facing the challenge of climate change, of food insecurity, of gender inequality, because you as the woman are probably doing everything for the family, including working in the fields and working if you're a smallholder farmer. And so I think what the challenge for us is to listen much more effectively and to understand development and our responses through the eyes and ears of those people. It has helped us a bit to understand better climate justice. And I think the same way we need to talk to those in communities who are grappling with HIV and AIDS. Now, we work very, very strongly through the Global Fund, which looks like a huge, enormous global organization. And I was in Geneva, and I know their headquarters in Geneva. But I think the trick is, and I think the Global Fund is doing this, is to try and come from that big, big global presence to actually listening to people. And we do that through organizations like Frontline AIDS. But I think what I'd like to hear from you is how we can do it better. frankly, because we do it. We can give you examples, but it's not how we describe our work every day, to be perfectly honest. We have a tendency to describe our work in terms of the impact of the very large grants that we give to organizations. And I think at the same time, we need to start thinking of it and describing it and implementing it by listening to the people who are living with HIV and AIDS in vulnerable communities.
Thank you, Michael. If I can bring Olive into the conversation, since we mentioned the Global Fund, Olive is the Community Rights and Gender Department of the Global Fund to Fight AIDS. If I can ask you, in your experience, what role do local communities play in shaping and implementing effective HIV AIDS initiatives?
Thank you so much. And thank you for inviting the Community Rights and Gender Department, the Global Fund, to be part of this conversation. I would also want to just thank the family of Father Kelly, Michael Kelly, and my panelists here. My sister, Winnie, thank you so much for that speech. It was powerful. You moved and you reminded me of so many things, the gaps, but the opportunities as well. Yes, as Global Fund, we have come from far. I always remember, I am Malawian, but worked in Tanzania for a regional organization called Eastern Africa National Networks of AIDS Service Organization for 20 years before I joined the Global Fund. And I have seen what the power of the Global Fund. And I'm saying this because of the work, especially when it comes to communities. Before then, communities did not have a voice. We didn't see a coordinated response where issues around, you know, the needs and the priorities from the communities being able to be voiced and being able to be included within policies and programs. Through Global Fund and through the support that Irish Aid and through the Irish people, we have seen what it means to include the needs of the most vulnerable communities. Those that are ostracized, those that are kicked out of their homes, those that are not accepted because of who they are, those young women and girls who cannot access services because of one reason or the other. And we have seen that through the voices of the communities, we have been able together to save 59 million lives in the last couple of years. I am saying this having first-hand experience. I remember in those years, I'm going to go track a bit backwards. In those years, within my family, I've experienced two deaths of two families. When I say families, it means a father, a mother, children. And the second one was my sister-in-law. And when she was diagnosed with HIV, she actually cried and told me, "Olive, I don't want to die. I wish there was medication." And for me, I celebrate her life today. And I celebrate it because of the work that the communities are able to do. I have seen treatment, care, literacy, and that has come up from the community organizations that the Global Fund is able to support through the support from the government of the Irish Aid, the government of Ireland, and through Irish Aid. But secondly, is I've also noted for us to maintain that treatment, there's a need to make sure that stigma, discrimination is removed. And that is also the role of organizations. Community-led responses, even when you are able to access services, there are issues. And these issues have been highlighted through community-led responses. Again, I would like to say thank you. I would like to appreciate the Global Fund the Global Fund appreciates the role of Irish Aid. I am going to say this. I know I am employed, but I'm going to say this. The organization that I used to work with, IANASO, was sponsored by Irish Aid. And there were two big partners. And at that time, we were trying to make sure that communities are able to participate on the CCM, the country coordinating mechanism of the Global Fund. And that time, no one wanted to be on the global on the CCM. But through the support that Irish Aid gave IANASO to build the capacity for communities to have the knowledge and have the confidence to speak in decision-making platforms, we have seen what the difference has been up to now. So I won't talk a lot. I think there are so many other examples I would like to say, but to just appreciate Irish Aid and the people of Ireland. Thank you.
Thank you, Olive. So I often find sometimes hope is something that we need to kind of work at, you know, to keep alive. And these conversations are just so hopeful. And thank you very much for those words, Olive. But coming back to you, Winnie, in relation to storytelling and policy, you know, the relationship between the two. I mean, you so beautifully have demonstrated the book, the first time ever a book to be co-authored by five African women, a combined lived experience of 125 years. That's really quite something. So talk to us a little bit about how storytelling can actually shape policy and shape public perception about HIV and AIDS.
Well, thank you, first of all, again, you know, for giving me this opportunity to talk, you know, to address you, but also to talk about what I feel is a really important book. What prompted us to write this book was the more than 40 years since HIV was first identified, you know, in the UK and in Europe. And within the African communities in the UK, because people are, you know, are struggling a lot, literally for survival, migration issues, also a lot of different things. People tend to focus a lot on challenges. We do not talk enough about the good things that are happening that our communities are doing. So I thought, who better than to speak of these good things than the people within the communities themselves, people living with HIV, women from different African countries, and to put a book together that's not only just about people living with HIV, but our allies, you know, policymakers, doctors, nurses, you know, because we've all been working in partnership, you know, to make sure that, you know, there are no new infections, that, you know, that we get on top of HIV. So, this book is a passion project of more than 40 stories of different people, everybody talking about what they feel it was important to them in terms of their work, in terms of their story, in their own words. And that's really important. You know, we all wrote in our own words. You know, we've never... The five of us who wrote, you know, who put this book together had never written a book before. We had to take creative writing classes. We had to do workshops. We had to partner with an organization in the UK called Positive East in order to be able to access the funds to put together this book. But everything in this book has meaning, including the artwork. You know, it tells a story of our journeys, of this pattern, which is a tsunami. Like HIV is a tsunami. It comes, but then when it hits, after it hits, everybody chips in to be able to recover, you know, to work together, to recover together. You know, it's a book of hope. We need to continuously find that hope within the work that we do. But the most important thing is to listen to the communities themselves. And I know it is a difficult time at this particular time. No money, cost of living crisis everywhere. But the money is there. It is there. We just need to find it. and do the work that we need to do and make sure that it is what the communities want, to respect what they have to say and to involve them at the decision-making platforms, not just to consult them, go back and then form our own messaging. And the message comes out and the communities say, what is that? We never subscribe to that. So we all have a lot of work to do, and we need to shape the conversations together. But if you're sitting in a room at a, you know, in a discussion, and you think, who is at the table? Think of the person that's missing, and then make sure you talk about that and highlight that.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Vinny. Just such a privilege to just listen to all of you speak and share your insights. Bring it back to Ireland, Stephen. Stephen, you're the executive director of HIV Ireland. Could you share, I suppose, some examples of successful community-led initiatives your organization has undertaken in the fight against HIV and AIDS, and what impact have they had, had on affected communities here in Ireland?
Great. Yeah, thank you. So our organization works to both in the sort of prevention sphere, where we are trying to ensure people have access to good sexual health prevention options. And also we are trying to educate particularly healthcare providers and social care providers about the impact of HIV on communities, and for them to have knowledge when dealing with clients and when dealing with patients coming before them. And we also try to advocate then around, you know, better practice, advances in HIV care, advances in, policy initiatives to, you know, make it easier and better for people living with HIV and people vulnerable to acquiring HIV to live their lives, to live their best lives. And there are successes in how we go about doing that. And I'm really pleased to hear you say we should focus on those successes, because very often we find ourselves in a space where we're being critical, or we're trying to say, well, this is not happening fast enough or well enough. We think we have done things that could be considered good practice. One example would be our Empower program, which works with men who have sex with men, gay and bisexual men. And that is a community-led initiative. So that is a program of gay and bisexual men for gay and bisexual men. And it's staffed by a large number of volunteers from that community who come and actually work with other members of the community face-to-face, on the phone, online, to provide these kinds of services. And a good example of how communities really pull together to generate success is when COVID happened. So when COVID happened, sexual health services fell off a cliff here. Not because, you know, people didn't want to provide those services, but COVID overtook many of the response options that were available. The community of people working with Empower stepped up to the plate in ways that, you know, you could barely imagine. People were still very frightened of the COVID virus. They were still very frightened of, you know, what it would mean to be in close proximity to somebody. And they were hearing a lot of public health messaging around, you know, staying apart, staying home, staying safe. And yet this community arrived at our door and said, okay, we can't provide the rapid testing services for gay men that we would normally provide in community venues because those venues are closed. We'll do it here, and we'll invite people to come here because we know people are still going to have sex and people are still going to need access to sexual health services and access to testing. And those guys came week after week to the building, and we had special permission to be there. And some services did have permission to keep operating in that way. And we had permission to be there. And those guys stepped up and said, we will continue to meet our community and continue to ensure they get the care and the services they need. And I think, you know, behaviors changed in during COVID, but not so much as people stopped having sex. They didn't stop having sex, of course. And they needed those services, and they got them through their own community. And I think that's a huge, hugely important example of how communities can lead. The other thing that, you know, I can talk a little bit later about things we're trying to do in terms of other community engagements. One of the things we did around that time as well was we conducted some research, and I'm a big believer in finding the evidence and listening to what the research respondents are telling you, and then trying to reflect back those recommendations that come from those communities to policymakers, so policymakers can help us succeed. One of them was we did a report with sex workers. We explored their experiences of criminalization and how that manifests itself in various legislative sort of provisions. And things have changed in Ireland, certainly, in terms of how we deal with sex work, and there has been changes. But we wanted to listen to the voices of sex workers about that and what their experiences were. But out of that, and we could talk a lot about that, but out of that, we also heard about the lack of peer-led services for sex workers. So sex workers are saying, we want to access services, we find it very difficult. We find it very difficult to get over the threshold sometimes. There's a lot of stigma, a lot of pushback, and we just don't feel the services are open to us in the way maybe we can access them. But wouldn't it be great if we had peer-led services? So services for sex workers by sex workers. So that's another aspect of work that we really begin to think about and say, can we do things in the community, offer testing initiatives to people, whether it's sex workers or whether it's trans people or whether it's people from migrant communities, can we offer services that they could also be a part of and let them lead? If you and I know that's what we're talking about, but that is the information that came back to us. So they're saying, listen to us and also let us be at the front of those service and at the front of that service provision. So those are the successes I think can happen when you open your mind and open your eyes to what communities want.
That's incredible, Stephen, because it really shows that at the end of the day, people will trust peers. Mm. You know, you're more likely, you know, especially from a group that there's huge stigma, say like, for example, sex workers, they would trust each other. Mm. But for them to go to walk into a clinic where they know they're going to just get a lot of judgment, but that's really very heartening to hear. The fact that people, you know, came to you, like the men from the men having sex with men, the gay men saying, look, we want to do this. And then also for your organization to go, okay, let's do it. Because you could have easily said, no, guys, we've got this.
We could have taken a really conservative view. But the program leaders in HIV Ireland, who run Adam Shanley and my colleagues who are there, they really, they championed that and said, the community is ready to do this. They want to do it. Can you facilitate us to do that? We couldn't say no. Of course we wanted to open the door, and still we had to put in all the measures, etc. But it was really great to see communities do that. And they've done similar things. Just, I know we're stuck for time, but they've done similar things in response to MPOX. Really great community initiative, pushing people to get vaccinated and pushing people to get tested, where MPOX arose, and also when there was increases in syphilis, etc., you know, that have been kind of a public health emergency at the moment. And that community keeps stepping up again and again to do it and to be leaders in their own field. So it's great to see.
Yeah, thank you, Stephen. It just goes back to, as a psychotherapist, you know, we would be very much working person-centered. You know, when you work in a person-centered manner, then real change occurs. So the same way, if you are really trusting a community-led or community-centered manner, then you're really going to inspire a lot of change. And also the sense of value that the individuals at the forefront who are, you know, battling with HIV and AIDS, that they're able to actually help. You know, that in itself gives, you know, in relation to men. Back to you, Michael. In relation to a policy perspective, how can governments like Ireland really, I suppose, leverage their influence on a global scale to further promote community-led responses to HIV and AIDS in regions facing significant challenges, Michael?
That's a very good question. And when you say person-centered, it reminds me that the Sustainable Development Goals are described and designed to be human-centered goals. But of course, they were adopted by presidents and prime ministers gathering in New York in 2015. So there is a gap between the intention and how you actually then act to implement them. So for Ireland, Irish Aid, I think it's really important to say, is an integral part of the Department of Foreign Affairs. So it is, as an aid program, it is the Irish people's aid program. Now, we do have missions and programs abroad, mainly in Africa, which work very, very directly and increasingly directly with communities. And we, our aim, which I think we are doing more than we've managed often in the past, is to bring the voices of those communities in Tanzania, in Uganda, in Malawi, into our policy making. And that has informed how our policy is focused on the furthest behind first, working to reach the furthest behind first. Now, that sounds good, but it's not the way many, many countries are running their development programs at the moment. There is a questioning sometimes in Europe of a focus on Africa. There is a questioning of a focus on the poorest and most vulnerable communities. So Ireland needs and to play a role and does play a role in promoting our values and our approach very, very clearly. And it's we do so in the face of these poly crises. Now, I would say that what we really showed in September of last year and again this year was that we can bring these approaches to the highest levels at the UN, in for instance, in the UN General Assembly, when ministers and politicians meet. For the first time this year and last year, I would say that development and humanitarian issues were on a par with what used to be described as political and security issues, because we are building a much greater understanding of the linkages between them. In the old days, it was seen politics, political and security issues were the true diplomatic issues, and the rest were something called aid issues. But I mean, we are now working to ensure that development, human-centered approaches are at the heart of our foreign policy. And the critical thing is that we learn from the work in our embassies with communities, and that what we learn there informs our policy. And we've done so a lot through the Global Fund, I have to say. We really are pleased with the effectiveness of the Global Fund. We're one of the founder members in 2002. I think we've provided as a country nearly 300 million to the Global Fund since then. But the point again that I would make is that it's your development program, it's your development policy, it's your foreign policy. So in addition to us listening to communities in vulnerable and isolated areas, we also need you to act to influence policy also. So you need to hold us to account, and you need to influence the politicians on the approach to be taken. So that's in a way we want to hear, we want to listen to communities, including our own community. So I just would say that we need to hear a little more from you too.
And Vinny, did you want to add to that?
I really want to ask a question, because there are different issues that are coming up at the moment. And I just want to get a sense of how you're dealing with these issues. There are a lot of draconian laws being set in different African countries, especially, you know, and laws around anti-homosexuality, laws around sexual reproductive health of young people, laws around congregating. You know, these are things that threaten the gains that we've made in HIV. And I'm wondering how organizations like Irish Aid are navigating this, because these are delicate space.
Yeah.
You know, when you're working.
Diplomacy.
Yeah, requires a lot of diplomacy, but you have to focus on the realities of the people that need services. So how are you managing? And I know it's not an easy, you know, question.
No, it's not.
I just need to know a little bit.
Michael's able for it. Well able for it, Michael.
Well, look, it is a big issue for us. We took on in the Human Rights Council some years ago the lead on the issue of civil society space. It's actually a terrible term because most people don't know what it means. But it is about the shrinking space for civil society organizations to act, and an increasing authoritarianism in the world. It is hugely political, and the situation is getting worse. I think in COVID, there were developments where the COVID excuse was used to close down the space for organizations who were saying things that might seem difficult to an authoritarian government. So we are working hard on this. Now, not just multilaterally talking about civil society space, but also in our programs, but also in taking a strong position on some of these issues. I mean, the anti-homosexuality legislation in Uganda, We have come out very, very, very clearly in opposition to that. But the Taoiseach has spoken absolutely clearly. We were in Uganda and we spoke to ministers about it. And we have told the Ugandan government that we believe this is wrong and that we believe it is not in the interests of Uganda. And to be honest, we are also concerned at the source of some of these moves, where they are coming from, because they are not necessarily coming from Africa at all. So at the same time, I would say we have made in our foreign policy LGBTQ rights a much, much more prominent issue in terms of human rights. And the other, something we have done quite recently, is we have announced a new SRHR, Sexual and Reproductive Health and Rights Initiative, which something that Ireland wasn't known for in years gone by, but we are increasing our work as an intention, as a direct intention to increase our work on SRHR. Now, even within Europe, in the European Union, as you know, there is a questioning of a lot of the gains that have been made, a questioning even on the concept of gender equality. So Ireland is to the fore with some other states in fighting against that, in pushing back against the pushback. But it is an international challenge to us. It is a challenge to development, and above all, it's a challenge to human-centered, person-centered development. So we're doing our best, but we will continue to work harder.
Thank you, Mark. See, I knew you were well able for that, Michael. Well able. If there's any questions or comments from the floor, we'd be very happy to hear your voice, because we are really trying to co-create a conversation here, and it's not just about the panelists up here, but I know there's quite a bit of insight and quite a bit of expertise on the floor. So, oh, we have a hand straight up there at the back. Now, do we have a roving mic? Yeah, no, we've got a mic to you. Thank you, Maisie. So you might just state your name and the organization that you're from and then pose your comment or question.
Sam McConkie is my name. I'm from RCSI Medical School, and I provide clinical care to many hundreds of people with HIV in Beaumont Hospital as a day job. I did work in Gambia and Sierra Leone, so I've worked from the other side of the Global Fund as looking for money. I was going to bring up the question that just arose there between Winnie and Michael about the use of law. One of the challenges with communities leading is that you don't have the full power of law and order and governance behind you. And I would ask the panel, apart from what Michael's mentioned, are there other examples of how we can use law? For example, inheritance law, so women and wives can inherit their husband's property. Can we change law to make things better for people with HIV? I give the example of Brazil. They made HIV access to treatment a human right in Brazil about 20 years ago and have had great success with antiretroviral therapy. So I would suggest that communities should be looking to what laws can we change to improve situation for people with HIV, including women.
Thank you very much for that contribution and question. Olivia, would you like to respond to that?
Yeah, thank you so much for that question. And I think it's a very relevant and very key question, especially right now as we are seeing, you know, drastic laws, and especially as we've gained a lot in the past, but people always want to take us backwards and through legislative, you know, laws that are not conducive to the response to HIV. I just wanted to say, for the Global Fund, we have what are called strategic initiatives. This is funds that are given in addition to the country grants. And this one of such an initiative is called Breaking Down Barriers. We are looking at what are the key issues or barriers that hinder us from moving forward. And this also looks at laws, legislation, and policies that cause harm more than make people move forward. And what has been done within the Breaking Down Barriers, the Human Rights Strategic Initiative, is assessments are carried out, and these assessments are done at country level, and then a plan is developed which now looks at how can we move forward. And we've seen dialogues happening, dialogues between lawmakers, dialogues between the law enforcement officers and communities. We've seen, like in a place like Uganda, where there is that, you know, pushback. We've seen people sitting down, having a dialogue with their police, with the prison, you know, people from prisons, and just having those straight conversations. We have seen, you know, gender desks within the police being activated once more. And we've also seen the media coming, asking questions around, you know, why human rights and what can be done to improve situations. And laws that hinder people from accessing services, being able to be questioned, but also the literacy around human rights, and even when it comes to stigma, discrimination, making sure that information is out there and people can respond. The other thing that the Global Fund is also working on is what is called Community Engagement Strategic Initiative. Before funds or before a grant is signed, we have communities can come together through a dialogue, sit with their fellow other civil society from other constituencies. When I say constituencies, I mean like people who use drugs or people who inject drugs, sex workers, the LGBTQI community can sit and converse and look at what are the priorities. And as such, the Global Fund, through the support through this Community Engagement Strategic Initiative, provides funding for consultations, provides funding such that communities are able to access technical support, sit, and then come up with those recommendations. And some of these dialogues are not easy dialogues. They bring people who normally would not sit together. And those priorities are pushed into the grants. And this is all because of the support that the Global Fund receives through thank you so much.
Thank you. Vinny, please.
Yeah, I'll try and respond. I totally agree that, you know, it is a process, continued advocating and making sure that, you know, laws that negatively impact on the lives of people living with HIV are reversed. And it takes a long time. It takes work. And sometimes there are different ways of doing things. I'll give you a personal example. When my father died, we were five. It was five of us. I have three brothers, and I'm the eldest, and I have a sister. And though my dad did not write a will, he confided in his best friend to write something down, and he said, although I want my son to be my heir, I want all my children to inherit my property. That was an individual decision. Sometimes waiting for laws takes a long time. And we need bold, you know, individuals who are determined to make a difference. It was not easy, and even when I talk about it in Uganda, when I'm with, you know, with relatives and stuff, they shake their heads and I say, you dare me and you'll see my wrath. Because my father was forward thinking and he did this on his own. And we need a lot of different individuals, you know, also making these bold decisions and, you know, changing their attitudes as things evolve, but also including changing the laws. There are so many different ways we can do things, but that's just one example. And I was proud of my father, still proud of him.
And I say he's very proud of you, Vinny. I mean, come on. Okay, so are there any more questions? Oh, we have a question over here.
Good evening. My name is Joe Green. I'm the co-chair of the Los Angeles County Commission on HIV in California. The themes that I've seen tonight and heard, I've heard at the International AIDS Conference, which is stigma, discrimination, criminalization. We've heard that tonight. What innovative methods are you coming up with to address stigma, discrimination, and fear? Because that at that level, we're not gonna overcome what we're facing now. So any suggestions? We had our annual meeting last month. We had 100 of the best minds in Los Angeles come together. We could not figure out a solution to address stigma and the fear that's within the community. Locally, it's the same here, it's the same there, it's the same everywhere. So what are you doing to address stigma?
Thank you very much. Stephen, do you want to take
that? It's a great question. And it's obviously a hugely broad area. And in one way, you know, I could give you an example of something we're doing and say this is an approach that we've adopted to combat stigma. But the question is about a more strategic approach to, you know, changing attitudes around HIV, changing attitudes of the general public towards people living with HIV, changing attitudes within communities impacted by HIV. So there's so many things that you can do, so many things that we have to consider. What we do about those things is a much harder nail to pin on the board, much, much harder. Last week, I was fortunate to attend a Fast Track Cities conference in London with partners across the UK and Ireland. And stigma was a really dominant theme about, you know, okay, we're getting to 95, 95, 95, and that's happening. And isn't it great that we've introduced all these initiatives like opt-out testing, etc., but we're still not getting to, you know, we're still not reaching people on this issue of stigma. Communities still have an inbuilt fears. Communities still have these barriers. They face them whether they're accessing healthcare or whether they're you know, having in their community, that they're within their own community or seeking relationships or etc. or in employment, whatever. All of those things are coming up again and again and again. For me, again, I think understanding stigma is really important. So we produced this year with a colleague in the University of Galway, well, the colleague in the University of Galway, in fact, produced the research, and we were proud to support the production of it, on healthcare workers, you know, what is their view of HIV and people living with HIV accessing healthcare. And there again, even after all the education, even after all of the stuff that's happened, even after all of the advances, you're finding that 40% of people in healthcare were saying, yeah, I think twice about drawing blood. I actually would. I just feel uncomfortable about it. You know, and suddenly you're back, you're like, well, we're back to square one then. If you can't even, with all the stuff that's in place, the infection control procedures, the education, the learning, you know, the messaging, the positivity, if inherently you are feeling some sort of fear or rational fear around this, what are we missing? Why can't we get through to people? That's the case. And again, we interviewed people living with HIV for the same study, and they were saying, yeah, you know what, I've had an experience that's really negative when I've accessed healthcare in Ireland, and, you know, I'm not going to go back. I'm not going to actually access that healthcare again. So not only is the stigma barrier there, but now it's causing another health issue for that person, because they're going to, in some way, have an adverse outcome because of this. So what can be done to change minds and attitudes? To be honest with you, from where I sit in our organization, I feel like once upon a time in my life, I knew a lot more about HIV than I do now. I don't mean about the mechanics and the technicalities of it. I knew nothing about HIV really when I came to work for the organization. And it's been a learning experience to learn all about communities, to learn all about what it is, how it impacts people, what changes have happened. But I heard about HIV a lot more when I was younger. I heard about community, and I heard about, you know, people in the public eye, you know, living with HIV and AIDS. You don't hear those discussions anymore. And when I'm talking to people not in my field and not in the sphere, they just look at you and go, HIV, you know, is that even, you know, they just don't know. And this is just an anecdote. It's just an anecdote, right? And but it's been bugging me for months and months. We have a project that we're instituting in our building, which we want to advance, which is provide a counseling hub, a space for people to get psychosocial support. And we wanted to make it a kind of a garden project. So we have this big Georgian building on Eccles Street, and out the back, we've put in one of those garden rooms, very nice. And it was kind of, we got it on a deal, and it was really good, and it's a lovely space. And in the back garden, there's a real imagination of what this could be as a community space. This could be landscaped and developed into something that you'd see off the TV, right? Really, like, you know, transform your garden. It could be this. And we even have people who want to come and do that, transform it into a pocket forest or whatever it is, right? But to get the actual labor done, we have to go out and ask people to come and quote. And people, again and again, said, we'll come to your building. They'd come to the building, and they wouldn't come through the door. Now, I don't know why they wouldn't come through the door. And I'm not casting aspersions on anybody. But there were people calling us saying, we're on the street. we're looking for your number. And then I guess they got to the door, and could it be that they went, HIV? Yeah, I'm not doing that. Could that be the case? 10 times we asked people to come and meet with us, and 10 times you couldn't get them to come through the door. And it can't be a coincidence. If it's a coincidence, fair enough, and I'm wrong, and I'm just talking off my top of my head, but it can't be a coincidence that people didn't want to come through the door, because they don't know, and they see the words or the letters, and they go, I don't feel that. That's okay. So we've come a long way when we're talking to ourselves, but out there in the world, people don't know, and the fear is palpable, and the step away, and the sort of, you know, so what's the strategic response to that? I think a good deal more public discussion about HIV is needed. And it's fine to say U equals U, and it's fine to say can't pass it on, but there's a lot more people don't know about and are afraid of, and I'm wondering, are we getting that message out there?
It's so interesting, because people are so annoyed with builders anyway, because you can't get one for the love of money.
And now we're just being builders.
We have even more reason to not like them.
Once again, there are so many different ways of dealing with HIV's related stigma. And just to build on that, one of the things we wrote up this book was that maybe it's a different way to have conversations around HIV. People can buy this, read a story, learn something different on their own, in their own homes, in their house. But one of the things that we did intentionally when we put this book together was we required everybody who contributed a story to put their photo with their story. We did not agree to any anonymity. And there were people who say, I'll write something, but I don't want my photo there. I'll do this, but not my photo. I want a different name. I said, no, you're owning your own story with your photo and your words. And that is one way, intentionally, how we tried to deal with stigma. But there's so many different ways. We wanted to change a lot of narratives with this book, you know, around around issues like African people don't work together. We work together, people from different countries. Africans can't produce something that is maybe nice, or a book, beautiful book with everything that is about us in so many bright colors. You know, the single story about our challenges, that is, something that bugs me. There are amazing stories in here of resilience, strength, and hope. You know, just to turn that around, you know, to be able to tell things differently. But stigma is a challenge, and it is a journey. We are not going to, get it done in a few years. It's going to take time, and we have to constantly find new strategies of dealing with it. Yeah.
And Michael, if I can ask you that question around stigma and the work that Irish Aid does, are there initiatives to try and raise awareness around and break down stigma through the work of Irish Aid?
Well, yes, but I think what's really, really clear is that we actually need to deal with the situation in Ireland that you're talking about. Because how we work is not to walk into countries and communities and say, you need to change your laws, you need to change your attitudes. The only way we can work with them in partnership is by bringing our own experience to bear. And that's the good and the bad experience, to be honest. They have to, we have to bring our learning from our mistakes also. So the more that we can bring in our development policy, our learning from what we are doing in Ireland, the better. Now, when it comes to stigma, there's a challenge, I can see that. I mean, we know we as professionals and as people working in this area know what the situation should be. But I think it's really important when we talk to communities in developing countries that we bring our own, with honesty, that we bring our own experience to bear on it. I would say that it's only by being open about our own situation
that we can actually work with others to change their situation.
And just on that as well, because it touches on the legal question that came up as well. In previous roles, I've worked in human rights at the convention level, at the treaty monitoring level. And what's funny about that is when you go to Geneva and you talk to people about experience, let's say at the time we were talking about, in fact, racism and hate crime, and we would say, you know, Article 27 of the Convention on Civil and Political Rights says X and Y about equality and racism, etc. So, you know, please, committee, can you recommend to Ireland that A and B happen, you know, and then we'll satisfy that, and there's a recommendation, and you go home and you talk about it. And that's fine, except nobody's listening at home. It's like, what? Who cares? But when you say, you know, that 1 in 5 travellers will be impacted by suicide, or traveller men, should I say, like, that's a lived experience. That's a real story. So the research, the understanding of what's happening, you know, right there, that's the thing that does tend to change minds. So we can do the legal stuff, and we can say things should be X and Y in Ireland, and can you please advise us how to do this? Also, learning and listening from what's actually happening on the ground and taking that back. So the sex workers, what their experience was, the trans community, what their experience was, GBMSM, what's your experience? What happened in COVID? Did you get access to services? Yes or no? No, actually we didn't. We couldn't actually get access to health. How many? 40% of us couldn't find that access, and that's led to adverse outcomes. Those things, those tangible pieces of knowledge and information, they do tend to make people go, oh, really? 1 in 5, 1 in 3, 1 in 7, 20% of new transmissions this year are women. Oh, that's interesting. So those things do tend to, I think, land a bit better. But you're right, getting our house in order is really important. I will say, in Ireland, we're lucky because we can talk to government, and we can talk to policymakers, and they do listen. The door is open. We're participating in committees where we're asking and trying to get answers and trying to move. And people are saying, tell us a good policy approach to this. And we get to say that based on our research. That's important. And not every country has that. And it's worrying to see in the European Union slippage in countries that are in the European Union, that are subject to EU laws. You know, we're lucky and fortunate to live in a collective where there is this oversight mechanism in Europe about, you know, the legal framework that exists, but yet countries are moving away, and that's worrying, you know. Yeah,
I'm conscious we're coming to time. Brida, I'm gonna leave you to ask the last question, and we're gonna see. It better be good, Brida. It better be good. Normally it is, and I might ask everyone to maybe respond. To
Brida. Hi, Brida.
Hang on, hold on, Brida. Hold on.
Thanks, Brida Gahan, the Senior Health and HIV Advisor with Concern, for 35 years this year, same as Marking World AIDS did, Red Ribbon, 35 years. My burning question is actually, we're week 47 in Ireland. This year alone in Ireland, we've 854 new diagnoses of HIV to yesterday at week 47. Globally still, there are 3,600 plus new HIV infections every day. These people will need testing, treatment, counseling, support, psychosocial care for life. We are not doing well on prevention anywhere. How can we do better on prevention? And I agree totally that we need to increase the visibility in Ireland, and literally from where Concern works, from Afghanistan to Yemen, we are doing terrible on prevention. And 90% of the funding for HIV prevention is underfunded still in 2023.
Can
we
I
need to protect young people. I am very worried. 15 to 24-year-olds, adolescents, 10 to 14-year-olds, 15 to 19-year-olds. This is life-saving education that needs to be delivered in schools, peer-to-peer, to prevent young people being infected.
Thank you,
Brida. Can I come in on that very quickly? It's really important.
She's and good. Brida's good.
It's really important. And Brida is a champion because she says it every week. She says, this is the number of newly notified cases. What are we doing to affect change? And it's a question that I see every week and I go, that's the right question. But I just to clarify that a little bit, everything you've said is correct. There is 850 newly notified cases. What we found from last year's analysis was there was 850 newly notified cases. That is cases that the HSC becomes aware of and counts, or the health services, the Health Protection Surveillance Center counts, if whether that person is newly diagnosed or previously diagnosed. And the vast majority are previously diagnosed people linking to care. And so what we saw was last year, 173 new diagnoses, which is a bit of a fall since the pre-COVID levels. So maybe some of the things that we're doing, I'm not trying to give you a get out of jail free card, but maybe some of the things that we're doing are working.
Thanks.
But at the same time, exactly as Rita says, that is 854 people who weren't known to be living with HIV last year, who are now known to be living with HIV this year. What about them? Let's not just go, yay, new transmissions are going down. What about the people living with HIV now, and as you say, for the rest of their lives? So what about them? What do we do in that situation? What, so that's why there's a real need to tackle stigma and to and have better education and to go into schools and say, you know, let's talk about these things that we don't want to talk about.
Yeah. Thank you, Stephen. We are going to wrap up. So very quickly, if you can go back to Michael, Olive and Winnie, just to respond to what Brida said. Michael.
No, I'll be very quick. Yes, I agree. We have made massive progress in human development, especially here in Ireland. We have made massive progress, but we are living in an age of serious and increasing inequalities. And that is really important for us to understand. The Sustainable Development Goals were agreed in 2015, and very soon started the ambition sort of waned, and we started going backwards in terms of the indicators, all of them, including SDG 3 on health, but all of them, poverty, hunger, and all of this is related to the experience of HIV and AIDS. So, I mean, it's an easy sloganistic type thing to say, but the news is completely dominated these days by wars and deaths and killings and bombings and destruction. And it just kind of occurs to me that if the international community was paying a little more attention and putting more resources into the achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals, that it's not idealistic to say I think we would have fewer of those wars. So I think we have to, in September in New York, we got the attention of world leaders on the lack of progress on the SDGs. And I think we have to find a way to keep that at the top of the agenda, and that will have an impact on at the individual level. But we have a big challenge.
Yeah, I would just like to add to say we need to take a multi-sectoral approach, looking at one individual, but what is it that involves that person? And I think, as Michael is saying, it's looking, especially when we are supporting. What are the causes? How can we bring more information? How can they, you know, in terms when it comes to the sustainable development goals, which are we lagging behind and how can we support at country level when I look globally? I think we need to take that approach whereby we're identifying where are we lagging and how can we support a better targeted strategy. I'm also looking in terms of, I think we had a discussion around how do we get communities more engaged. I feel like this is taking us to look at a person as an individual and then seeing, you know, there are other it's a multifaceted approach that we should look at, bringing people together, let them have those conversations, let them identify what are the key needs. And in such a way, we'll also be able to open up that those conversations have begotten, let people be able to be have more literacy around the key issues that they are experiencing. And in a way, that opens up in terms of the stigma, in terms of discrimination. The more we talk about it, the more people get to know about it, the more acceptance, and the more we can change situations. And I think it also talks about funding community peer-led organizations that they are also able to talk about prevention strategies. And also, you know, sometimes it's also mental health that we don't talk about as well. How can we make sure that the approach is integrated? Yeah, those are some of the key issues that I just wanted to mention.
Thank you, Olive. And final word to you, Winnie. No pressure. But you can handle it.
People's lives are complex. They're really complex. But I think it was Michael who said that inequalities are a big issue.
and we have to address those inequalities, and to start seeing the differences in terms of new transmissions. But there are so many different things we can do. Really, I do not have an answer to this. What I can say is lives are complex. Really, lives are very complex.
Thank you very much. So a round of applause to our wonderful panelists. So thank you so much. We have come to the end of tonight's... big thank you to Stephen O'Hare, Michael Gaffney. We had Olive Mumba, and of course, we also had Winnie Sanyu Seruma. So thank you very much. Very much. So I think you'll agree we had a wonderful evening, a wonderful conversation. Thank you all for being here tonight and for keeping HIV and AIDS high on the agenda. We appreciate all feedback on this evening. So you will see some copies of an evaluation form around the room. We would be very grateful if you could take a couple of minutes to fill this out to continue, I suppose, improve and develop this this event year in and year out. There's also a QR code on the screen so you can complete a digital copy of this form. There you go. There will be also a reception with canapés and wine, so please do stick around to continue the conversation. A huge thank you to all the speakers and all of you for being here. Now, the HSC Healthcare Harmonies Choir will now close the event with another song. I believe you're going to be playing singing Tender by Blur. Yeah, and we end the evening, of course, by thinking of Father Michael Kelly and the incredible legacy he has left in all of us who continue to fight against HIV and AIDS in Ireland and across the world. And of course, Father Michael Kelly's family members are also here. So thank you so much for being here tonight. So thank you. Safe home. And now I leave you in the hands of Emma Crehan, who is the director and singer-songwriter and the HSC Healthcare Harmonies Choir. Thank you. Woohoo!
Tender is the night, lying by your side. Tender is the touch of someone that you love too much. Tender is the day, the demons go away. Lord, I need to find someone who can heal my mind. Thank you.
Dreaming of a white Christmas, just like the ones I used to know, where the treetops glisten and children listen to hear sleigh bells in the snow. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, with every Christmas card I write. May your days be merry and bright, and may all your voices be one. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas like one I used to know. May your face up, listen and listen to hear sleigh bells in the snow. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas with every Christmas card I write. May your days be merry and bright, and may all your Christmases be
me. I wrapped it up and sent it. Read the note saying, I love you, I meant it. Now I know what a fool I've been. But if you kiss me now, I know you'll fool me again.
Last Christmas, I gave you my heart. The very next day, you gave it away.
Thank you.
Thank you. This one's like to say when no one's listening.